Father God, we thank you for another opportunity to present your word and to hear eternal mysteries unveiled. We pray that the power of the Holy Spirit will accompany the proclamation of the word so that we hear with divine understanding, divinely imparted insight and inspiration. Let that be the case in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Welcome to the next session of our glorious inheritance, the revelation of the titles of the children of God, based on volume one of the book series. We are studying this fantastic title that God has placed upon his people of kings. God refers to us as kings and lords and princes in the word of God. And when you see the unveiling of what that means, it is just absolutely incredible. And there's going to be a special emphasis on the word dominion, the word crown, the word throne, all of these things associated with our calling to be kings. Now, in the last session, we ended with that fantastic statement of Hannah in her celebratory psalm, where she's celebrating how God gave her the answer to her prayer. She had Samuel, and she dedicated him to God. And then in chapter 2, there's this outbreak of worship prophetically that I'm quoting from in 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 8. Hannah said, "He raises the poor from the dust and the beggar from the dunghill and sets them among princes to inherit the throne of glory." God raises up the poor from the dust and the beggar from the dunghill to set them among princes and to make them inherit the throne of glory. What an incredible statement that God takes us from the bottom to the top. We were bound to the dust of mortality and the dunghill of carnality, but God has lifted us up to a whole new level in life where we are seated among princes, children of the King of all kings. And everyone in his home, everyone in his household has a royal nature. We are princes reigning and ruling with him in this world. And he makes us to inherit the throne of glory, which means sharing with us his position of power and authority in the world. Now, that's where we ended last week. So we're going to focus our attention on what it is to be a prince and what that means to us spiritually. Now, I give you the definition in your outline. A prince is defined as being a monarch, a king, the ruler of a principality or a state. A prince is a male member of a royal family, especially the son of a king, or a prince is a nobleman of varying rank or status. Finally, the fourth definition that you'll find in any dictionary is a prince can be a person of high rank or high standing in any particular class or profession. And so sometimes it's just a title given out of respect for the excellence in a person's life. He's the prince among this or the prince among that, the prince of writers or the prince of videographers or something like that. Now, in Psalm 45, verse 16, we are referred to as princes in all the earth, which if you apply it to the last definition of what a prince is, it means we should excel in our calling. We should excel in our purpose. We should excel in our destiny, whatever that particular slot or niche may be. But it also means we're all children of the king and he shares his authority with us. Princes in all the earth. Now, the particular scripture that is from is Psalm 45, verse 16. Also, in Isaiah 32, verse 1, we have a prophecy of the coming new covenant. And the prophet Isaiah said, "Behold, a king shall reign in righteousness, and princes will rule in justice." Now, the king, of course, is the Lord Jesus Christ. Many kings that have occupied thrones in this world have ruled with oppression. They've ruled unjustly, dishonestly, with hidden agendas. They've ruled by manipulation and coercion and many different attitudes and actions, kept their throne stable. But the Bible says this king rules in righteousness. All of his attitudes, all of his actions are righteous in nature. He doesn't depend on any other source of controlling sovereignly that which is under his charge, except that which is righteous, that which is pure, that which is holy. A king will reign in righteousness, and princes, or the children of the king, will rule with justice. In other words, one of the reasons God has called us to be subordinate princes in all the earth is to execute righteous and fair and just treatment of fellow human beings. I believe it is the influence of the church through the centuries that has caused culture to be changed in a positive and good way over a period of many years, so that people are treated with fairness and treated justly and treated with kindness and compassion. And instead of the poor just being oppressed by the rich, it's usually people in the church that uphold the rights of the poor. And we should be an influence for good and for justice in that area. In fact, Martin Luther King, who championed the rights of the black race especially, said this. He said, "Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere." And so it's up to us, the church, to see injustices in this world and to do something about it, to deal with it. And in so doing, we reign with Christ. I read stories all the time of courageous men and women of God who go into areas where people are treated very unjustly, and they make a difference for good and for the kingdom's sake. May God use all of us in that way to lesser or greater degrees. And then it's not just some title we claim. It has very practical application in the way we work it out in this world that is so opposed to the kingdom of God. And in so doing, as I give to you in your outline, we emerge in the image of our elder brother, who also bears many titles with the word prince. And I list them here. In Isaiah 9:6, he's called the Prince of Peace. And I love that title, referring to Jesus. In fact, that's one of the favorite prophetic scriptures of the church. We hear it quoted all the time around Christmas, especially. You hear people referring to Isaiah chapter 9 and the verse, I think it's 5 and 6, that says, "Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." And I've heard it said that when you go through that progression, you arrive at a peace that is indescribable. When you realize he's wonderful, that's usually when you first get saved. And then you hit problems and disappointments and trials and tribulations, and he becomes counselor. His word written and also his living word counsel you through all the battles of life. And then you realize he's the mighty God. He can work everything out. And then you come to the revelation that he was the embodiment of the Father of all creation on earth. He said, "He who has seen me has seen my Father." And you realize he wasn't just a great teacher. He wasn't just that prophet which was to come. He wasn't just Son of God, but he was God manifested in the flesh. And when you realize that, he becomes the Prince of Peace to your soul. Well, it may not happen exactly in that order, but that's something to ponder. I do know this, that if the government was upon his shoulders, and the Bible went on to say, of his government and peace there will be no end, then peace and God's governing authority go together. The more he governs your actions and governs your thoughts and governs your will and governs your life, the more the Prince of Peace imparts his peace to you. These are thoughts that I dwell on often. He's referred to as the Prince of Peace, the Prince of the Host. Of course, the host being the multitude of angels in the heavenly realm. He's the Prince of Princes. We are his subordinate princes. He's the Messiah, the Prince, and all those are from Daniel's writings. He's the Prince of Life. Peter talked about that, how they crucified the Prince of Life, the Lord of Life. What an enigma that the Lord of Life was caused to taste death for every man. And yet this Prince of Life emerged victorious. Then he's also referred to in Revelation 1:5 as the prince of the kings of the earth. And I do not believe that's talking about natural kings, but rather the spiritual family of kings that we are as sons and daughters of God. And we're going to find out there's a powerful scripture that makes that a present tense inheritance, not just a future hope. Also, I think it's important to see that not only are we individually referred to as princes in scripture, but we who are in covenant with God have been grafted into Israel. And that word Israel, though its meaning is controversial, many people interpret the name Israel different ways. If you go back, however, to Genesis 32:28 in the King James Version, that's when the angel of the Lord wrestled with Jacob all night long, and then the angel of the Lord, which was the pre-incarnate Christ, the Messiah before he took a physical form, he said, "Let me go, for the day breaks." And Jacob said, "I will not let you go until you bless me." And then his response was, he said, "Let me go, for the day breaks. And he said, "I will not let you go until you bless me." And then the blessing came in the form of a name change. He said, "Your name shall no more be called Jacob, but Israel shall your name be. For as a prince, you have power with God and with men, and you have prevailed." And based on that passage and that particular rendering of that passage, many people feel that the name Israel means ruling with God or reigning with God as a prince. Others share different ideas. But if it does, we have all been grafted into Israel by virtue of being born again. We are all part of that eternal entity called the Israel of God. And if we are a part of this Israel of God, which I believe every born-again member of the church is a part of, it includes the redeemed of the Old Covenant, the redeemed of the New Covenant, all fused together as one eternal entity, then we will rule and reign with God over a new creation forever and ever. Isn't it strange, and yet not so strange, that God prophesied through, I believe it was Jeremiah, who said, "Though I make a full end of all nations where I scattered you," God speaks to Israel and says, "I will not make a full end of you." So God promises one day in the new creation to come, all other nations will be no more. But the one nation who has God in its name will persist forever. Israel, the word El in Hebrew, means God. And we will be ruling and reigning with God forever. Also, corporately, God's people are referred to in a feminine term, in the term princess, found in Psalm 14, verse 13. It talks about the royal daughter. The royal daughter is all glorious within the palace. Her clothing is woven with gold, or is of wrought gold, I believe the King James Version says. So we are referred to as a royal daughter, the king's daughter, who is all glorious within. Internally, we've been washed, we've been changed, we've been transformed by the blood of Jesus and given a royal nature. And so God, in a good way, exploits every human relationship to render a symbolic view of our relationship with him. We are referred to in Scripture as sons and daughters. We are referred to as servants to a master. We are referred to as a bride with a bridegroom, and now referred to corporately as the daughter of a king. So God uses many of these human relationships to represent our spiritual relationship with him. Now let's jump into the revelation of what it is to be kings reigning with Christ. It's not just a future hope. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 8 puts it this way. It says, "You are already full, you are already rich, you have reigned as kings without us," Paul says to the Corinthian church. "And indeed, I wish you did reign, that we might reign with you." And so the Corinthian church is in a city, in a culture that is immersed in immorality and idolatry and sin and debauchery and uncleanness. So I believe the primary thing that Paul is referring to when he says you have reigned as kings, they've reigned over their past, they've reigned over the negativity and the darkness of the culture they're a part of. They've reigned against all the opposition and persecution they've faced and the internal problems they had as a church. They've dealt with them and conquered them. And so they're reigning with Christ. And he uses this symbol of a king as representative of the way they were in a mode of victorious living. And that's the same with us. This, the New English Bible translates the passage we're about to read, which is Revelation chapter 1, verses 5 and 6, as a royal house. We are God's royal house. The New King James Version says it this way. It says, from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, the ruler of the kings of the earth, to him who loved us and washed us from our own from our sins in his own blood and has made us kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. He has made us, not will make us. It is not a future hope, but it is a present tense reality. He has made us kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. Kings and priests to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. So it's underneath the headship of the King of all kings, but we are his subordinate kings. Now, two things that I want to explore for a little bit that we normally associate with kings are great riches and great authority. Great riches and great authority. So if we already have been made kings and priests, reigning with Christ, what kind of evidence can we find that we occupy such a royal role and that we're part of such a royal house? Well, there's a number of scriptures I list here that talk about the riches you have inherited as a child of God. You are kings, and therefore you have an abundance in your life, the abundance that Jesus promised to bring. Now, Jesus referred to a certain kind of riches as being true riches in Luke chapter 16, verse 11. And the scripture also says in Romans 10, 12, that the same Lord over all is rich unto all who call upon him. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean wealth monetarily. True riches are spiritual riches, wealth emotionally, mentally, intellectually, supernaturally, spiritually. It may overflow into prosperity in the natural realm. And certainly God has done that and continues to do it today. Prosperity is a promise of Scripture. But more scriptures deal with spiritual riches, or what Jesus referred to as true riches in Luke chapter 16, than those normal, natural, material riches we usually use the word to mean. Now, I have a list here that I believe we need to go over. Proverbs chapter 10, verse 22 says, the blessing of the Lord makes one rich, and he adds no sorrow to it. Quite often, material riches bring sorrow with them. Not necessarily, I believe that that doesn't have to be the case. Jesus told the parable of the rich man, Jesus didn't tell the parable of the rich man, but a rich man came to Jesus and said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And he said, well, take all your riches and sell it off and give the money to the poor, and you'll have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me. And he went away sorrowful because of what Jesus had said. And then Jesus said, how heartily shall they that trust in riches inherit the kingdom of God? Which shocked the disciples. They said, well, who can be saved? Peter said, who can be saved? And Jesus said, with God, all things are possible. With men, it is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. And I take that to mean that when a person who is wealthy financially and materially yields his life to the lordship of Jesus and comes into a covenant relationship with him, in the realization that all those possessions no longer belong to him, but rather belong to God, then with God, all things are possible. Then if he's walking in covenant relationship with God and in cooperation with God, then riches can be extremely beneficial to the kingdom and a blessing to that person's life and to the lives of others. But far too often, riches become idolatrous in people's lives, and because of what the lifestyle that goes along with it, great sorrow is the result quite often. Sometimes the most miserable people you meet might be some of the wealthiest people you meet. So it doesn't necessarily provide the joy that human beings think it will provide. I've met poverty-stricken people that had extreme joy in their lives. So joy is something sourced in a relationship with God. And out of that, everything else should flow. All right, next, Romans chapter 2, verse 4 shows us the first way that God pours his riches into our life. He says, do you despise, and this is talking about, or actually this is a rebuke to judgmental people who have forgotten how good God has been to them. And he says, do you despise the riches of his goodness, forbearance, and long-suffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leads you to repentance? So the first way God made us rich was by giving us a sensitivity to what is evil and what is good, and to know the difference between the two, and to feel convicted and remorseful and regretful about that which is evil or has been evil in our lives. The first way God makes us rich is to give us a heart to repent. And we don't really view it that way, and yet the scripture does. It talks about the riches of God's goodness being poured out on our life, and how do we know God's been good to us? Not just because of material acquisition or because of some great accomplishment in life that worked out well for us, but the first sign that the riches of God's goodness has been poured out in our life is God gives us the ability to say, I'm sorry for my sins, Lord, I repent, come and change my life. Most people don't associate God's goodness with that. They don't say, oh, God's really been good. Why? Oh, my heart was just smitten with grief over this mistake I made, and I repented, and God set my path straight. Well, it is rich to be able to have that softness of heart toward God and to feel his healing virtue. Then Romans 9:23, I love this passage of scripture. Let me back up to verse 22. It says, what if God, willing to show his wrath and to make his power known, endured with much long suffering the vessels of wrath fitted for destruction, that he might make known the riches of his glory on the vessels of mercy which he had before or had prepared beforehand for glory? What if God, willing to show his wrath and to make his power known, endured with much long-suffering the vessels of wrath fitted for destruction, created for destruction, that he might make known the riches of his glory on the vessels of mercy? Seems to me that glory and mercy go together. In fact, that's the way it was in the Old Testament. You have the mercy seat, the lid of the Ark of the Covenant, where the blood of a goat was sprinkled one time a year on the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur, lifting the sin debt of all of Israel, the high holy day of the year. And that was on the mercy seat that the cloud of God's glory rested, the Shekinah referred to by Jews, the manifest presence of God. So the glory of God and the mercy of God are found together. Why? Because the very fact that God would pour his glory on our lives is an indication of his great mercy. Because all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You ought to confess it, though. I am rich in the glory of God. And there's so many ways that manifests. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. What does that mean? All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Well, what is the glory of God? That he is above sin. That his nature is utterly perfect, absolutely righteous, without flaw, perfect love, perfect joy, perfect peace, perfect wisdom, perfect knowledge, perfect understanding, perfect humility, perfection in all his ways. That's his glory. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. However, in John chapter 17, Jesus prayed and he said, Father, I pray not only for these, but all that will believe on me through their word. Father, I pray that the glory you have given me may be in them. The glory you've given me I give to them. So he prayed that glory in our lives. He prayed his divine nature into our lives. He prayed his manifest presence into our lives. And that's what the glory of God is. You ought to confess it. I am rich in the glory of God. I am rich in the goodness of God. Hallelujah. And then Ephesians chapter 1 verse 7 says, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. What is grace? Grace is two primary things. Grace is God's unmerited love or unmerited favor toward you. Grace is always God's divinely imparted ability in you as well. So God expresses his love towards you by awakening his ability within you, and all of that is grace. Paul said, I am what I am by the grace of God. And here it says, according to the riches of his grace. God pours out his grace into your life richly. And what happens? Your sins are forgiven and you have redemption through his blood. And the word redemption means to be bought back and brought back with a purchase price. He redeemed you by his blood. He loosed you away from bondage, and it's all the riches of his grace pouring into your life. Listen, you and I have got something to shout about. I am rich. I am reigning as a king with Christ. I'm rich in his grace, rich in his glory, rich in his goodness. And the next one says in Colossians chapter 3, verse 16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, in all wisdom and teaching, admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. So when the word of Christ dwells in you richly, then there's an overflow of praise in your life, an overflow of a worshipful atmosphere where your life is filled with meaningfulness and purpose. And you're a joy to be around. If the word of Christ dwells in you richly, then it changes your character, transforms your personality. It turns you into a container of heavenly virtue in the midst of an earth that is in a fallen and broken state. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Then I love this verse. Well, I love them all. But James chapter 2, verse 5 says, listen, my beloved brethren, has not God chosen the poor of this world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom which he has promised to those who love him? Sometimes the poverty-stricken masses of this world have no other option but to believe. They don't have any other path they can explore for a solution except to just believe and to trust God in certain kinds of situations. And sometimes they don't have all the trappings of logic and reason and intellectuality and philosophical views that sometimes weigh down the minds of people that are highly educated or have a lot in life. Sometimes we just get encumbered with things, and it's harder to believe God. Trusting in riches, trusting in intellectuality, trusting in logic, trusting in reason. Just throw it all off and trust in God. And be rich in faith. Listen, my beloved brethren, has not God chosen the poor of this world to be rich in faith? Well, that descriptive phrase, poor of this world, could also mean those who have poverty of spirit. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. You show me someone with poverty of spirit, and I'll show you someone rich in faith. What does it mean to be poor in spirit? Well, of course, to be poor naturally means you are at a place of utter abject poverty, materially speaking. But to be poor spiritually is to recognize, is to acknowledge that you are in an absolutely bankrupt state mentally, emotionally, spiritually, without the Lord Jesus Christ. You have to admit, without any reluctance, without him I can do nothing. And then you've achieved a poor in spirit attitude. And when you get to that place where you say, without him I can do nothing, you inherit everything. Because he said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Well, what does the kingdom of heaven comprise? Everything that God has and everything that God is. So first I've got to admit, in Adam I've got nothing, I'm bankrupt. And then you take the next step of saying, in Christ I have everything, I'm rich beyond description. In fact, the Bible calls it the unsearchable riches of Christ. Infinitely in unsearchable. You go from nothing to everything the moment you make Jesus Lord of all. Praise God. Now, this particular aspect of our inheritance is highlighted by two names that God has given us, both from the same passage. Different Bible versions give us two different names of a passage out of Psalm 22. Psalm 22 and Isaiah 53 are the two passages of Scripture that in great detail forecast what Jesus, the Messiah, would go through on the cross. In fact, Psalm 22 starts out with one of the seven last statements of the Lord Jesus Christ. My God, why have you forsaken me? And then it goes into a description later on in the Psalm. In fact, we should go there. Let me read a little bit of it just so you can see how powerful it is in describing what Jesus went through. Psalm 22, and let's say around verse 14. He says, I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted in the midst of my bowels. My strength is dried up like a potsherd. My tongue cleaves to my jaws. And thou hast brought me into the dust of death, for dogs have compassed me. The assembly of the wicked have enclosed me. They pierce my hands and my feet, and I may tell all my bones. They part my garments among them and cast lots upon my vesture. Of course, those are all prophecies of the Messiah to come. And David, the one who brought forth this psalm, is so identified in the spirit with the coming Messiah, he speaks it in the first person, because it's not really him, but the Spirit of Christ in David foretelling these things. But then in verse 29, it says in the New King James Version, all the prosperous of the earth shall eat and worship. The NIV version says, all the rich of the earth shall eat and worship. All those who go down to the dust shall bow before him. Eat what? All the prosperous of the earth, all the rich of the earth, shall eat and worship. What are they going to partake of? What are they going to eat? Well, we just read a description of the crucifixion. And did not Jesus say, except a man eat my flesh and drink my blood, he has no life in him? Of course, he was talking in spiritual terms, because he was the Word made flesh. To eat his flesh means to eat and digest the Word into our inner being. The life is in the blood, and the Holy Spirit is referred to as the Spirit of life. And some people feel that when God breathed into Adam, that's when the blood was formed in his veins. And so they're inseparably connected to each other. So to eat his flesh is to devour, to digest the Word of God into our life until we become one with the Word. And to drink his blood is to drink in the very life and personality of God. And the rich of the earth are the ones who eat his flesh and drink his blood, that recognize the price that was paid on Calvary and receive the benefits of it and respond in worship as a result. And we are referred to in the New King James as the prosperous of the earth. Prosperity beyond description comes to those who partake of the cross. Riches beyond compare come to those who partake of the cross, insomuch that this becomes who we are. Now, also kings possess great authority. Unopposable authority, of course, unless there's an insurrection or a rebellion against them. But in this case, God as King of Kings is an irresistible authority, and the kings reigning under him partake of that kind of that level of authority. And listen to what Jesus said in Luke chapter 10, verse 19. Behold, I give you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. I had a problem with that scripture when I read it the first time. I said, God, there's something wrong here. I said, there's got to be something wrong here. Either the Bible's wrong or I'm wrong. And I know the Bible's not wrong, so maybe I'm wrong in my interpretation, but you said nothing shall by any means hurt you or harm you. I said, God, I've been harmed. I've been harmed by this world. I've been harmed by my own bad choices in life. I've been harmed by relationships. I've been harmed by disappointments. I've been harmed mentally. I've been harmed emotionally. I've been harmed spiritually. You said nothing shall by any means hurt you or harm you. And I've gone through great harm even since I've been a Christian. So God, what's wrong? And what God spoke to me is so priceless. He said, those things may have had power to harm you temporarily, but they did not have power to harm you permanently. And then he went on to explain to me that because God is a genius at turning curses into blessings and darkness into light and stumbling stones into stepping stones, that he exerts his divine authority, he injects his divine authority into the most negative experiences of our lives, and then in genius manner, in amazing and miraculous ways, he takes the worst things we could have ever faced and brings forth some of the best transformation in our lives as a result. It may be extremely painful to go through, but all things work together for good to them that love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son. And that's what everything is working toward. Look back into your past. See the most painful things you've ever faced. In fact, look at your own personal failures that have created the greatest pain in you internally. But you came through it. You gave it to God. You prayed about it. You cast your cares on him. You cast your burdens upon the Lord. And now you can look back and see how that changed you in a very positive way and made you a more loving person, a more forgiving person, a more compassionate person. In many ways, you were changed more into the image of the Lord Jesus. So what looked like it was against you ended up being for you. That's why nothing shall by any means harm you. At the end of the day, it's all going to come out in the wash. Praise God. Being washed in the blood of Jesus. Now let's go back to the statement though where Jesus said, behold, I give you power over all the power of the enemy. Now in the English we have the same word, power and power. But in the Greek it's two different words and the difference is essential. He says, behold, I give you exousia over all the dunamis of the enemy. Now exousia is a word translated power that means authority. I give you authority over all the dunamis. Dunamis means ability. So if you were to put it in those two words, Jesus said, I give you authority over all the ability of the enemy. Well, see, the devil and his demons have the ability to put certain things on you, to attack you mentally, to attack you emotionally, even to attack people physically. There's all kinds of satanic attacks going on in people's lives. But he said, I give you authority over their ability. And authority wins out over ability. Let me give you a little analogy. Just suppose you've got a little country town with one traffic light that goes out on a particular day. And there's a Barney Fife kind of law enforcement officer with a big badge on his chest standing out in the middle of the road to stop traffic when necessary. Little scrawny, skinny guy, and barreling down the road is this big tractor trailer with a big, husky, bearded, rough-looking dude at the wheel. Now, the guy at the wheel of the tractor trailer has the ability to run over top of the police officer. But the police officer, though smaller in stature, and it looks like he's no match for this oncoming vehicle, still, when he stretches out his hand, he has the authority to stop the one who has the ability. And he'll hit his brakes and come to a screeching halt. Because he knows there's an invisible host behind that little Barney Fife individual. And if you don't know who Barney Fife is, you're probably in a much younger generation than I am. But go back on YouTube and see some old programs. But anyway, there's a host behind him, lending their authority to him. Everyone else in the police department will rush to his rescue. And then all the police departments in the whole state will stand up and defend his authority. And then you've got the highway patrolmen. And then you've got the whole infrastructure of the legal system throughout the entire United States. And they will all back up the authority of that one little police officer resisting the ability of an oncoming tractor trailer driver. Well, in like manner, there's an invisible host behind every one of you. A multitude of angels. The Lord of hosts, the God of an army of angels, gives his ministering spirits command concerning you, the heirs of salvation, to keep you in all your ways, lest you dash your foot against a stone. You are divinely protected by the Lord of hosts. And the authority of the scripture, the authority of God, backs you up. When you stand against the authority of the enemy, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, God, who is three in one, backs you up with his authority and his power. So that when you speak not on your own, but he said, if any man speaks, let him speak as an oracle of God. Let him speak as if God is speaking through him. Now, that doesn't mean that you can indiscriminately say whatever you want to say at any time you want to say it and just have your way. But it does mean that you can exert authority in the face of demonic attack and expect to win in that battle of life. I love Romans 5:17 also. It reveals that at one time death reigned over us. The Bible said in the beginning, God warned Adam and Eve, in the day you shall eat thereof, you shall surely die. Well, the day they partook of the tree of knowledge, they didn't die physically. Did God lie? I've had people withstand me on that and say, well, from the beginning, God didn't tell the truth. Well, yes, he did tell the truth. They died spiritually and began dying physically. There's a couple of ways you can interpret it, but that's the one to me that seems the most logical. They died spiritually because at that moment their spirits died. Man is a triune being, and the spirit functions in three particular ways. It functions in communion with God, number two, revelation from God, and number three, conscience. The soul functions in three primary ways. Mind, will, and emotions. And then the body is made up of three primary things, flesh, bones, and blood. And so we are triune beings, and every one of those three parts of our being is triune in nature itself. But the spirit died, and so communion with God was cut off, revelation from God ceased for the most part, unless God initiated it. The only thing left in man was a barely burning conscience where there used to be a flaming fire of sensitivity to God. And so when God said we were dead in trespasses and sins, that's intentional hyperbole. That's an exaggeration. You're not absolutely dead, or you'd have no capacity of ever repenting. But you're nearly dead, as close to death as you can be spiritually before God retrieves you. It's just like intended exaggeration, like a man coming home from work after he's worked all day long. He plops down in an easy chair and says, oh, I'm just dead. Well, you're not really dead, but physically you feel about as close to that as you can get. Exhaustion is set in, and so it's intended exaggeration. God did the same in Scripture. So sin reigned over us. The Bible says sin had dominion over us and caused death. For if by one man's offense, death reigned through the one. So death reigned through Adam. Adam sinned, and death reigned over all of his offspring. We're born into this world dead spiritually, dead emotionally, dead mentally, on our way to death physically. Soulishly, we're under the influence of death on a daily basis. Death-dealing attitudes hit us all the time. We're walking through the valley of the shadow of death. And Adam brought it on us by one man's offense, by Adam's offense, Romans 5:17, death reigned through the one. But if that be true, then he says, much more, you ought to shout much more those who receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life through the one Jesus Christ. So prior to salvation, death reigns over you. But once you're born again, you reign over it. You reign over the death-dealing effects of this world. You reign in life with the Lord Jesus Christ, which is phenomenal. It's a wondrous thing. One particular version of that passage says we reign as kings in life. That's the Amplified version. We reign as kings in life because of two things. And we need to explore those two things. First of all, the abundance of grace. Secondly, the gift of righteousness. Let me expound a little bit more on grace than I did a few minutes ago. The scripture says in 2 Corinthians 8:9, you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. In other words, this is how you see it. This is how you behold it. This is how you recognize it. You know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, how that though he was rich, for your sakes he became poor, that you, through his poverty, might be made rich. Well, why is that a declaration or a revelation of the grace of God? Because we were the undeserving one. He was the deserving one. He deserved peace, and he deserved praise, and he deserved contentment, and he deserved a painless existence because he was flawless and errorless. We were the error-prone, sin-ridden children of darkness that deserve nothing from God, and yet grace is the abundant generosity of God toward undeserving people. So, you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, how that though he was rich, rich in what? Rich in the undisturbed peace of heaven, rich in fellowship with the Father, rich in the protection of paradise, rich in the abundance of beauty that is in that realm. And yet he divested himself of all those supernatural riches and came down to this world and assumed the form of poverty-stricken, fallen human flesh that was vulnerable, that was temptable. He could be tempted like any other man. However, he never erred, he never failed, he never was enticed into sin, but still he took upon himself that poverty-stricken form. He who was rich beyond description became poor, and he became more poor or poorer than at any other time on the cross. Because when he went to the cross, he cried, my God, why have you forsaken me? And the Holy Spirit departed from him as he became sin for us. So he was more poverty stricken at that moment than any other point in his life. And yet if we connect with him at the cross, overflowing from him into our lives becomes unsurpassed riches of heaven. You know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, how that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that you, through his poverty on the cross, might be made rich. Rich in a restored state, forgiven, delivered, set free, no longer under satanic dominion, no longer under sin's dominion. I am rich, and I found it where he was poor. What a demonstration of grace. And something else we need to know about the grace of God. It is sufficient. That's what God told Paul when Paul asked God, take this thorn in the flesh away from me. God said, my grace is sufficient for you. Now remember, I told you grace is unmerited love, and it's also God's ability poured into you. So God said, my grace is sufficient for you. My love, my care, my compassion, my forgiveness is sufficient for you, but also my ability that I poured into you is sufficient for whatever you're facing in life. And you need to understand this too, that 2 Timothy 1:9 says, God has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which were given to us in Christ before the world began. Ponder that passage for just a moment. God has saved us and called us with a holy calling. Holy, holy calling. Not according to our works. We didn't earn this because we were such good people or had such good personalities. Some of us were far from that. Some of you were good people before you got saved. I was not a good person before I got saved. But it's not according to works. God has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which were given to us in Christ before the world began. If God gave me a purpose before the world began, then God in his genius, in his omniscience, anticipated in advance all the grace it would take for me to fulfill my purpose. And I would dare to say he gave me not enough, but more than enough. Because 2 Corinthians 9:8 says God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that you having all sufficiency in all things may abound to every good work. Well, how much grace is all grace? Is it measurable? Is it definable? Can you tell when it runs out? Does it ever run out? I would dare to say that grace is just as infinitely inexhaustible as the God who gives it. And as long as you maintain three attitudes, faith, humility, and sincere love, there'll be a sufficient amount of grace in your life. Ephesians 2:8, by grace you're saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it's the gift of God. 1 Peter 5:5, God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Ephesians 6:24 says, grace be with all those that love the Lord Jesus Christ in sincerity. So Ephesians 2:8, 1 Peter 5:5, and Ephesians 6:24 show that as long as you maintain faith, humility, and sincere love for God, God is going to pour his grace into your life. Infinitely inexhaustible. I don't care how many times you get knocked down, beat up, thrown around, ostracized, hated, despised. I don't care how many times you disappoint yourself, but climb back to your feet and try again. Praise God, grace will meet you there. That's why you can reign in life, because of the abundance of grace. It's endless as long as you come to God with a sincere heart toward him. Praise God. And that means to me, if he gave me a purpose in Christ before the world began, and grace, that no matter what challenge he gives me in life, I've already got enough grace to fulfill it. Don't beg God for something he's already given to you before you even got here. If God gave you grace in Christ before the world began, then next time you face a challenging situation in life, say, God, I thank you because I've already got enough grace to handle this. You gave it to me. You knew I would face it before I knew I would face it. And so I have the grace to do it. I'm preaching to myself, and I hope is hitting your heart as well. The other thing that helps us to reign in life is the gift of righteousness. And I'm coming to the close of this teaching now. Righteousness is a gift. Wow, that sets Christianity apart from all other world religions. Hinduism, Islam, all of the major religions I can mention base salvation on human works, religious works, attaining it through self-effort. In Christianity, the lowliest sinner comes to the cross, and as soon as the blood touches you, 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, God made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Dwell on that just a moment. You don't just receive a status of righteousness from God. He fills you. Hunger and thirst after righteousness. And he said, you shall be filled. What are you filled with? His own righteousness. He pours himself into you so that in the sight of heaven you look, you appear as righteous as he is. That's a gift. And it comes through the blood of Jesus. So no wonder you reign in life. The accuser of the brethren and his accusatory demons underneath him can bring up every foul thing from your past to accuse you. And you can say, I am washed in the blood. I am the righteousness of God in Christ. Nothing can win against that if you are true and sincere in your love for God and your surrender to him. Now, these new covenant impartations restore to God's people the spiritual riches and the spiritual authority that Adam relinquished to the devil in the garden. So the calling to be kings is part of a restorative process. And I believe I'm going to end at this point realizing that, yes, we are kings, but this is part of a restoration of what Adam had in the beginning, because Adam was created completely righteous, and Adam was created for kingship, for rulership, for dominion. And we'll get more into the word dominion in a further teaching on this subject. So it's all about restoration. It's not something new. It's God taking us back to something old that was lost, but then enhancing it and making it even better than it was in the beginning. I do want to include here at the end that the calling to be kings is part of the blessing of Abraham. What God promised Abraham, and there's about 16 major facets to the blessing of Abraham, and one of them was that his offspring would include kings, which happened literally, of course, because there were rulers over all of Israel when it was intact, 12 tribes of Israel, and then when it broke up into two parts, and you had Judah, the southern kingdom, and you had Israel, the northern kingdom, there were a whole line of kings that reigned over those two parts of Israel. And so literally it was fulfilled in a very physical sense. And of course, in the dynasty of David that led down to the Messiah, the King of Kings. However, I believe there's also a spiritual application of it. In Genesis chapter 17, verse 6, God told Abraham, I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and kings shall come from you. Well, the Bible says that we are children of Abraham by faith in Jesus Christ. And so we tap in to the blessing of Abraham. They that are of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham, the scripture says. And the blessing flows into our lives that God has made us spiritual kings, and that's part of the Abrahamic blessing. In fact, Galatians 3:14 says, or let me back up to verse 13. It says, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us, that the blessing of Abraham might pass on the Gentiles in Christ Jesus, or might come upon the Gentiles in Christ Jesus, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Let me go through that again. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us, because it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles in Christ Jesus. Well, if I am in Christ, I'm submitted to the headship of the King of all kings, and part of the blessing of Abraham was a royal seed. You are that royal seed. You are kings reigning with Christ. You are the kingly seed of Abraham, our forefather. And it's a destiny that you will not only rule and reign in this world as it is now, but in the glory of the world to come. And we'll be talking more about that in the next lesson.